Well, hello, God bless you, Bishop Patrick L. Wood Sr. here, and I hope that you are having a fantastic day. I'm having a fantastic day. God is so good, and I'm as happy as a lark, and I am angry. I'm angry and happy at the same time. Now, I'm going to tell you what I'm so excited about, but I'm going to close on that high note. And let me tell you what I'm just downright disappointed about. And I think the world is going crazy. We're in the midst of the falling away, and people are doing just downright dumb things. Now, tonight, as the Washington football team, which I like that name, Washington football team. I think it's hard-nosed. I think it's tough. The Washington football team, previously known as the Washington Redskins, are going to be playing the New York Giants. And I don't know how, whether or not that's going to generate a whole lot of ratings or not. Here at the Upper Room, we normally have service on Thursday nights. And I tell you, nothing can compare to our Thursday night Bible study. Yeah, we study the word of the Lord together. But tonight in the NFL, they have designated tonight as Pride Night. One football player came out and told the world, I don't know why he felt he needed to tell it, that he's a homosexual, that he loves having sex with men, okay? Now he's not the best defensive end in the world, and he plays for the Las Vegas Raiders, and I'm not going to call his name. You can look him up. But anyway, it's amazing how a person would reveal something personal like that about themselves, just as the young man a few years ago who got drafted 248th or 249th. Nobody knows who the 248th or 249th NFL player is ever. This was during the Obama years, and so he got drafted, and all of a sudden it was a big deal. Now, he did make history being the only known 248th or 249th drafted player in the NFL. Typically, when you get drafted that low, don't nobody know it but your mama and your daddy. But because he was a homosexual, and he, by the way, gave his dad a call, and I think his dad was at a restaurant sitting at a bar when the son delivers the news to him. Of course, he didn't make the team, and he didn't make it in the NFL, and he's out, and I don't think his marriage survived either, so he's done. So now we have one who's in the NFL, and what is the NFL doing? Now, NFL, you can do what you want. You can have what you want. But let me just say to the people, to those who still have biblical morals and who still believe the Bible, these people are expressing pride in that which God calls an abomination. The Bible is right. The Bible is the word of God. And the Bible, believe it or not, existed before there was an NFL. And the Bible will outlast the NFL. And if the NFL keep going in the direction that it's going with these self-inflicted gunshot wounds, NFL will stand for not for long. But by the way, the Bible says in Leviticus chapter 18, in verse 22, thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. It is an abomination. And there are so many passages of scripture where there is no passage of scripture in any of the leading world's religions, especially in the one true religion, which is biblical Christianity, I believe it with all my heart, where homosexuality is promoted. And not to mention, you know, they say follow the science and follow the and medicine and biology. Well, if you go by biology, men aren't made to have sex with men, nor women with women. And yet we are now proud of this. And so a game where kids play, where kids tune in, where children whose worldviews and opinions are forming and they're being formulated and they're proud of their larger than life NFL stars. So now they got to sit through this, see a pride commercial at every break, and there's no telling how many little messages will be told tonight to try to make that which God calls an abomination acceptable, and we're proud of it. Well, I tell you, I'm not proud, and I'm saying this, and I'm praying that the believers out there who still have conviction that you not partake in something as wicked and as ungodly as this. Now you got the queer. Look at the categories: queer, questioning, gender non-binary. I'm not a male. I'm not a female. I'm a it or a they. Well, no. If we go by science, if we go by biology, if we go by DNA, if we go by any and every category, you are either a male or a female. So lunacy is being passed off today as intelligence, and they expect us to just go along with it, and I guess for us to be proud of it. I imagine that some carnal Christians and some of those who are Christians in name only would join in with the pride celebration and say, oh, how wonderful, and many black folk who look just like me have bought it hook, line, and sinker. You know, I know what it's like to be discriminated against, so I'm not going to discriminate against anybody. Well, it's not wrong. It's wrong. America was wrong. To this day, it's wrong to discriminate against anybody on the basis of their complexion or skin color. But there is behavior that is wrong in many states across the United States, it's still against the law to commit sodomy. The Bible declares that this lifestyle is wrong. And not only is the lifestyle wrong, but the Bible even speaks and says this in Romans chapter number 1 and verse 32. We're having a little Bible study here. The Bible says, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, but not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. Those who join in and applaud such wicked behavior, you are worthy of the same judgment that those who are participating in this behavior are going to be judged by. Because the day will come when we will all have to answer to the God of the Bible. And it doesn't matter how big you are, NFL player. It doesn't matter how big the NFL is or anything else. You're not bigger than God. You won't outlast God. And I'm praying for you because you're becoming a rather dumb company, league. How many of your viewers do you think subscribe to that? How many of the people who you think, I mean, you're talking about doing a whole lot for a niche audience. And so I just pray that people pay attention to what's going on, because in doing this, they're coming after your kids. They're coming after the boys. They're coming after the boys. Now, I know last year they had in a Division I school, they had a girl to be a punter. That's the only position she better go out for, because she certainly can't be a line. Gary, can I say lineman? If I'm talking about a girl, a line person, because if she get in that line or get into running back or become a defensive back or a linebacker or a defensive end or a tight end or a wide receiver going across the middle, a quarterback even, let me tell you, a center, an interior lineman, show's over. One play, bam, she's gone. So what is going on? We're trying to minimize the difference between male and female. And you know what? all of these things that are taking place are, by definition, anti-Christ. For God made them male, and God made us male and female, and the differences are to be appreciated and celebrated, not meshed into all this one thing. A guy once told me one time that a woman is nothing but a man with a womb. And I said to him, now, brother, maybe you married a man with a womb. But Patrick Wooden did not marry a man with anything. Patrick Wooden married a woman. And what a lovely woman indeed my wife is. Now, I'm shifting. I'm moving away from the craziness that had me upset with the NFL to what I'm so excited about today. Is my lovely wife, Pamela, my wife of 41 years. Today is her birthday. And I am so thankful to God for my wife. I tell you, she is quite a woman of God indeed. And we married back in 1980. And here we are in 2021, and the Lord is still blessing us. And even through these times and the pandemic, some call it a plandemic, and all these things that's going on, my wife has been right there by my side. And I tell you, every day I thank the Lord, not just for keeping me healthy, and keeping us on my feet and disease free and keeping COVID away. I thank God for how he has watched over my wife. And I've said to the Lord, God, if it has to happen to one of us, God, I'd rather bear that than to have that to happen to Pam. And today, honey, I want to wish you a happy birthday. Hey, listen, I got some things planned for her. And so now tonight, we will have service right here at the Upper Room Church of God in Christ, and the Word of God is going to be preached, and the Word of God is going to be taught. But I'm telling you right now, not by me, not tonight. I want to do something special with my wife, and all you married guys out there, you understand it, and preachers who understand the importance that the First Lady plays in your life, and the importance of your wife and how precious she is, and how you certainly want to acknowledge and treat her the right way. You certainly understand where I'm coming from. And I'm so proud of her. And we've been celebrating this week. And as you know, my anniversary, my church anniversary, I think my 34th, I'm getting a little confused here, is coming up Sunday. 34 years we've been pastoring here at the Upper Room Church of God in Christ, and my wife has stood by my side every step of the way. She's a brilliant lady. I say this often about her. My wife is beautiful, but she's not mere decoration. She plays she looks good, and she's quite decorative for the ministry, but she loves Jesus. She's a very smart lady. She is a praying woman of God. And I tell you, she covers this preacher in prayer. She's given me two wonderful children. We are proud grandparents of three. We have a fantastic son-in-law. God is so good. And I'm so grateful to God for my wife today. And my friends, I want you to tune in tonight. Now, we're going to have an awesome service. I got a powerful preacher lined up. It's going to be great. And I want you to tune in. But tonight, yours truly, I don't want you to be wondering where I am. Is anything wrong? No, it's just the opposite. It's wonderful. But today is her birthday. And I've set some things in order. You guys out there, you know what I'm talking about. You know, we do more than preach, pray, and sing. When the time is right, there's time to go on and, you know, get to be the man, take care of business. So I love you. I love you, and I love this. I love getting a chance to speak to you every Thursday. I thank you for your prayers. I thank you for your support. I thank you for how you have stood by me and are standing by this ministry. And make it a great day. The Word of God is going to be preached here tonight with power and authority. And when the Word is preached, I want you to say amen. God bless you. Make it a great day.